For any newcomers, new faces, welcome. This is the Faces of Humanity speaker session. I'd like to introduce the moderator for the next session. She's an award-winning journalist who spent a decade telling stories that matter to British Columbians. She was most recently being recognized nationally for uncovering the challenges Vancouver seniors face living alone with very little support. She's currently the assistant news director at CKNW in Vancouver. Outside of her work in journalism, she's co-chair of the Vancouver Pride Society. But her most important job is being mom to two children, and we have the youngest audience member over here. It's her. So let me introduce Charmaine De Silva.
Thank you, everyone. It's really great to be here to talk about, I think, what is an important issue and some important issues that are going to get more and more attention given the state of the world right now. We have three great speakers in the session on humanitarian aid for women and children, and I'm going to introduce all three of them sort of briefly, but I'll introduce each one a little bit more in detail before they each give their presentation. So we have Julie McKinley, who is the team lead for World Vision. If you want to raise your hand there so we can see who you are. Simran Singh, who is Senior Manager of Humanitarian Assistance for Care Canada. And Alejandro Terones, is that correct? Okay, good. Humanitarian Advisor for Save the Children. So first up, we have Julie McKinley, who spent a decade working in various roles within the Humanitarian and Emergency Affairs team, providing support to major earthquake responses in Pakistan, China, and Haiti. And as I said, she is currently the team lead with Eastern Europe, with a focus on Middle East and Eastern Europe, and primarily supporting the ongoing crisis in Syria. And so, Julie, do you want to come up and let's get the show on the road?
Hi, everyone. I realize that you can't see the details on that. I just wanted to put it up and give you kind of a general sense of the work that World Vision overall is doing as part of the Syria crisis. I'm going to speak to you specifically about some of the work that we're doing in Jordan. And I'm going to rely heavily on my notes because I landed last night from a trip to Asia. So apologies if I slow down a little bit. It's the jet lag catching up to me. So I'm going to speak to you about our project that we have going on in Jordan, which is referred to as NUR, and it's funded by Global Affairs Canada. The NUR project addresses key development challenges facing Jordan, including those that predate the Syria crisis, as well as those that have been exacerbated by the refugee influx. We're focusing on addressing pressing education, protection, and economic resilience needs for vulnerable Syrian and Jordanian women, girls, boys, and men. So NUR is an Arabic word, and it means light. So it's reflecting the overall goal of the project to shine light on the future of vulnerable children, their families, and communities. I have to admit that personally I become a little bit complacent with the figures as I read reports. I can kind of glaze and scan past them to some extent because they are so incomprehensible and ever increasing. 13.5 million people impacted by the Syria crisis, more than half of which are children. 2.9 million refugees living in Turkey. That's the equivalent of the entire population of, more than the entire population of Greater Vancouver, waking up tomorrow and needing to move and leave the country. According to the UN, $4.5 billion was required to meet the urgent needs of the most vulnerable Syrians in 2016. $2.9 billion was received. So, as you may know, this past week was an important milestone for the Syria crisis. It hit the six-year mark. Tragic, devastating, the worst humanitarian disaster of our time. 6 years has another significance for me, personally. I have a 5.5-year-old daughter. If we were a Syrian family instead of a Canadian family, she would have grown up knowing nothing but violence, war, fear, and uncertainty. So in World Vision, in the lead up to the six-year anniversary, interviewed more than 100 children from Syria, as well as from other safe countries, including Canada, asking about their fears and their hopes. Only 3% of Canadian children feared for their safety. They were worried primarily about robbers and falling through the ice. not Vancouver children, clearly. 43% of Syrian children feared for their safety from airstrikes and explosions. But we also asked the children about their hopes, and for me, that shows the true resilience and strength of the children. Syrian children still hope. They hope for peace. They hope to grow up and be pilots, doctors, and teachers. They hope to return to their own country. They hope to go to school. And we have the ability to make at least some of those hopes a reality. The newer project is setting up early childhood education centers in schools, similar to a preschool or a kindergarten here in Canada. On a recent visit to Jordan, I had the privilege of going to one of these schools. Walking in, I was struck by how similar it looked to my daughter's kindergarten class. Pictures on the wall that children had painted, you know, different groups of children playing with toys, others working on learning how to write letters and numbers. Playing, learning, and being a child is a privilege many of them will never experience. Our education work in the project is focused at this very early entry point for a very intentional reason, by providing these foundational skills, the children at least have a chance starting off their future in a reasonable setting for those children that have known nothing but conflict. We're trying to create that sense of normalcy as an entry point for them. And it goes beyond the children I meet in those classrooms. We're facilitating information sessions for the caregivers for those children, sharing tips and tricks. How did they continue the education and that learning with the children at home? What tools do they need? One of the teachers was telling me about a mother who attended those caregiver sessions. Her 5-year-old child, having their first experience with formal education, is already a teacher. That child comes home after their time and teaches their mother because their mother is illiterate and can't provide those skills to them. So the mother was not only happy about the opportunities for her child, but that child is then also providing that learning and education to that mother. So it has a ripple down effect. Okay. We're already seeing results in improved reading readiness skills for these children. And for them, this is the entry point into formal education and hopefully being able to move forward, as opposed to the children that have unfortunately, you know, not been able to return to school because they've been out for so many years. Humanitarian situations also pose increased protection risks for children and women. About 80% of the refugees in Jordan live in the host community, not in refugee camps. Because of the high costs of rent and other expenses, you'll often find 2, 3, 4 families living together in one small apartment. Worse is the families that are living in the unfinished buildings, the garages, those random spots where they can eke out any kind of shelter. This means limited privacy for women and girls, increased tension within families, which can lead to increased violence against women and girls. When the situation gets more desperate still, children are removed from schools, if they were lucky enough to go to begin with. Child marriage rates soar, almost tripling for girls under the age of 18, 12% in 2011, up to 32% by 2014. So as part of the NUR project, we're tackling this from several different directions. First, for children and youth who are not able to attend school, we've established child and adolescent-friendly spaces. For many children, there's no safe space to play. They don't go outside, they don't have a chance to interact with other children. Fears and concerns about a lack of acceptance from the host community also keep children and women inside. These interventions allow for a safe space for the children to be children, to play games, to meet new friends, and provide at least a basic level of emotional support. It also provides a forum for information sharing and awareness raising. I visited one of our centers, which was providing support for adolescents, which is often a portion of the population that gets missed. And the facilitators were discussing how the youth had experienced violence. Almost all of them had a fairly recent experience to share, either from family members, peers, school teachers. These centers also provide another valuable opportunity for parents, allowing them the time to take care of other household matters or work and earn an income, knowing that their children are in a safe space. Secondly, we're working with children in the schools through their child parliaments. That would be the equivalent of a student council, as we see here in Canada, to teach children not only about their rights, but how to be advocates for their own future, giving a voice to young girls who haven't had a voice in the past. The children are identifying issues that are important to them and developing plans on how to change those things. Some schools are focusing on how they clean up the physical environment inside or outside their school. Others are launching campaigns to improve road safety near their schools. The final component of the project looks at economic resilience using renewable energy technology. This component is still just getting underway, but the idea is that providing solar water heaters to these households, we can decrease their utility cost, and those very limited financial resources they have can then be put to other needs, like paying to stay in reasonable accommodation or having enough food to put on the table. Since women are often the ones responsible for taking care of those household tasks and dealing with the food within a family, there's a direct impact for those women. Additionally, this is also helping to address the drain on overall resources and infrastructure as a result of the additional people in the country. We're looking forward to the opportunity of these results come in the near future. So in summary, there's no single solution to the complex situation that we're currently facing. No easy answer, but that doesn't mean that we should stop looking. One of the most often heard requests from refugees and those displaced is, why has the world forgotten us? Why does no one care? So we all have a role to play in this, no matter how big or how small. I know it's hard when it's such a complex situation happening on the other side of the globe, but you don't need to understand the political dynamics of the situation. What you need to understand is that there are people in need. Sometimes the easiest thing to do is to make a donation, which, I won't lie, is definitely needed for us to continue doing the work we're doing. But there are other ways too. A simple act of discussing the situation with friends, family, colleagues, keeping a focus on the issue. Okay. As Canadians, asking for support from our government to continue to engage both at the humanitarian and the political side of things. And at the very least, trying to empathize with the women, girls, boys, and men that are living in unimaginable situations that have become their day-to-day reality. These are refugees, but they are also families who, until 6 years ago, lived lives that were not that different than ours here in Canada. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Julie. That was very informative, and I think it reminds a lot of us about exactly how things started in terms of the lives that people have, as opposed to what we see on the television screens and video footage now about the situation in Syria and in the Middle East. Up next, we have Simran Singh, who is currently the Senior Manager of Humanitarian Assistance team and a member of CARE's Global Gender Emergency Team. She has an extensive background in this field, previously working for CETA, the UNHCR, and DFID. And over the 6 years when she was formerly with CETA, Simran worked on Pakistan, focusing on gender and humanitarian issues, and with DFID's humanitarian response team to Pakistan, Kenya, and Philippines as well. She's from Vancouver, and we're really happy to have Simran here to tell us a little bit more about what she does.
Thank you. So I'm going to take a little bit of a different approach and talk about CARE's general approach to gender emergencies. So why do we work in gender, and why do we focus on it when it comes to emergencies? What we've realized over over 70 years of working in over 90 countries is that emergencies aren't gender neutral. Women, men, boys, and girls are affected differently. They have different needs, different roles, and different responsibilities. And so what we have also realized is, and a lot of evidence demonstrates this, is that women and girls are often disproportionately affected. So for example, after the tsunami, there was a higher rate of mortality for women because they didn't know how to climb trees. They didn't know how to swim. And that's something really simple that you take for granted, that, oh, I would know how to climb a tree. But what we see women and girls play an active role in their communities. We don't see them as passive recipients of aid. We see them as agents of change who are responsible for what's happening in their community and who have a vested interest in seeing their community succeed. So oftentimes when I do presentations about this, I get a question about, what about the men? And that's why I'm talking about gender and not just women and girls. For us, we need to know what the different relationships are between men, women, boys, and girls. It's not just about women and girls. Men and boys will often have different vulnerabilities in different contexts. So for example, in Yemen, we've seen that men are more scared to leave the home than women are. So that's resulted in a little bit of a shift of how people are interacting. And we also see the importance of engaging men and boys, because they all also want to see their family succeed as well. So I'm going to talk about three different pieces of work that CARE has done, and talk a little bit about some of the successes and challenges. And the first two, I'm first going to talk about Jordan, and Julie's done an excellent job of laying out some of the difficulties facing Syrian women. So we do a lot of work. Well, the hub of a lot of our work is a community center. So as Charmaine mentioned, I grew up in Vancouver, and I spent a lot of time actually working at my mom's community center, Collingwood Neighborhood House. So when I was in Jordan in June, I walked into this community center, and it seemed really familiar. It seemed very similar to what I'd seen in the past, with children singing off key and lots of like people running around. And so it was really interesting to have an opportunity to talk to Syrian women and talk about their experiences. And one of the things that we've been doing in this, in the center is doing livelihoods training. So as Julie mentioned, it's 6 years on into the conflict. Lots of people have lost their livelihoods, they've moved, they don't have the same skills, and we realize that women are actually obviously quite affected by this. So what can we do? So we said, okay, let's look at what kind of skills exist. So we obviously didn't want to train women on something like pagers, which was like no one's using anymore, or like train them on something that's not useful. So we took a look at what's happening in the labor market, and we thought, okay, you know what? There's an opening, thing people need seamstress. So we decided to train women, in part, there's a lot of other trainings we're doing on sewing. So you can see there's a bunch of women behind us, and they're learning different techniques. And not only do we spend time training women, we also provide them the actual input. So we'll give you a sewing machine and that sort of stuff. And we also provide follow-up support after. And one of the interesting things is because this is in a community center, women can leave their children in some of the other activities that children have access to. Because the one thing is, women often have double duties. They have the household duties, and then they have to work outside. So how do you actually accommodate that? And that's something we've had to take into consideration of saying, maybe we do trainings at different times, maybe we make sure that daycare is available and that sort of access. So that's one of the things that we're doing in a more long-term, protracted situation. And these are some kids doing some fun psychosocial activities stuff. West Bank and Gaza. So we've been in West Bank and Gaza for a really long time. And we've been doing this project on trying to get communities more nutritious food. So essentially there's been a food insecurity crisis going on. There's not a lot of access to good food. And part of that project, we felt it was really important to focus on women's leadership role. So we know that women have a key role to play in the agriculture sector, but they're not making the decisions. And so this is one of my favorite stories. This woman's named Jamila. And in the 2014 conflict, her kitchen that she ran with her women's organization was completely demolished. So everything was gone. And they were like known for the best food, like so everyone wanted to go to them and eat their food. And so this was gone. This was a huge loss for the community. So with CARE support, we helped them rebuild the kitchen. We helped them get better stoves, better fridges, better technology. So actually, the hygiene standards were better. Apparently, they had the cleanest bathroom one of my colleagues had ever seen, which was apparently quite impressive. And it just made things a lot more efficient. And it was to the point that they were able to then actually successfully land a contract for UN-led schools. So it was this huge thing that they got these skills, they were able to build back. And it also really actually demonstrated the importance of this women's organization in that community, and also the resilience of human spirit, right? Like, we often are working in places where it's the worst moment of people's lives, but to see people build back and to see women take on that role in society is really important. And then, actually, so we've been doing work in both West Bank and Gaza, and for those of you who don't know, access out of Gaza has been quite difficult. So what we did, and this was quite revolutionary, is we had women from West Bank and women from Gaza come together for an open day fair. So they brought all their products and they had conversations like, how do you make honey better? How do you make this better? And that doesn't seem revolutionary, but one of the women said, who was in Gaza, said, I never thought there would be a day I could leave Gaza. Like, the fact that I'm in West Bank is just, it was so shocking for her. And that's like me being like, I'm never going to be able to go to Burnaby, you know? And it's just so hard to conceptualize that, but that's the case. And for a lot of these women, they hadn't had that leadership role before, and to be able to be responsible for that and to be able to demonstrate to others some of the work that they've been doing, especially within their community, was quite amazing. And I'm not saying this is easy, and we face a lot of challenges. It's an iterative process for us, but that's why I wanted to talk about Pakistan a bit. And Pakistan is a fairly conservative community, especially in the areas that we work in. And we were facing some issues. So we were doing very immediate humanitarian work. Unlike West Bank and Gaza and Syria, we were doing immediate assistance for water and sanitation, building latrines, some hygiene work. And we realized, wait a minute, where are the women? Why aren't the women accessing services? And so we kind of started to look around. We're like, what are some of the barriers here? And we realized, really honestly, it was that women didn't have national ID cards. So without a national ID card, you just can't access services. You can't vote, you can't do anything. So we thought, okay, how do we get around this challenge? And what we actually did is we did mobile registration for national ID cards. So obviously before a white van shows up into your community, there's a lot of work that gets done to explain to communities why this is important. These are really remote communities who don't necessarily see a lot of outsiders come in. So there's a lot of discussions about what this means. And then we were able to bring in this van and to actually register women. And this is pretty revolutionary because these are women who may have been 30, 40, have gone their entire lives without actual ID. And so this is just the actual process of registering the IDs. And so from now on, all the time, if we do anything in Pakistan related to humanitarian assistance, we have this national ID component because we realize our work is going to be somewhat useless if we don't have this ID. So for CARE, the focus on women and girls underpins everything we do. What we think is it's not smart humanitarian assistance, it's not effective humanitarian assistance if you aren't looking at these different needs. And it is not easy, but this is a challenge that we're very firmly committed to and one we feel quite passionately about. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Simran. It is quite amazing to think about mobility challenges in the context of our community, not being able to go to Burnaby, and then also things we take for granted like an ID card. Very enlightening. Thank you so much. Our next speaker in this panel is Alejandro Torones. Alejandro has worked in humanitarian field for the past 12 years, recently joining Save the Children Canada as the humanitarian advisor. Prior to that, Alejandro spent the majority of his career working in the field with deployments to Turkey for Syria response, Haiti, Nepal, Liberia, Bolivia, Malawi, and El Salvador, and through organizations such as the British Red Cross, the International Rescue Committee, and the Danish Refugee Council. Thank you so much, Alejandro.
Thank you. So I'm going to focus today on one of the ways that we are able to provide aid to both women and children, and in general their whole families. Let me just start saying that, like, when we think of humanitarian aid, what is the first thing we think of? Usually it's long queues waiting to get food or waiting to access water or materials to rebuild their homes. And while this does happen, this is a very still common thing, we are shifting a little bit away from that in the humanitarian world. More and more we're trying to focus on transferring the purchasing power away from us, from the organizations, to the people. Why is that? Because they are the ones that know best what it is that they need. So instead of us trying to figure out what their needs are, say that, well, maybe if we can transfer the purchasing power over to them, they will do better at it. So that's what I'm going to talk about today for a bit. You know, this is what we're calling cash transfer programming. So cash transfers can be in a lot of different ways. For example, just giving people cash, physical cash. This is probably the simplest way of doing it, but it's also perhaps one of the least used ones because of potential security and safety issues. However, this was in Nepal, and Nepal, the situation did permit it, so we were providing people with cash in hand. Another form is through vouchers. So vouchers, imagine them sort of as coupons that can be traded in for a product or a service. You know, it's not just the paper vouchers in themselves, it can be physical tokens or even gift cards. Such as the same gift cards you would get here for, you know, Tim Hortons. We have done that in different places around the world as well. We can use card-based transfers. You know, in a lot of places where we work, the infrastructure is not there. But for example, in the Syria response, in Turkey, in Jordan, in Lebanon, you know, they're fairly developed countries, so there are strong banking systems, and we are able to use, you know, pretty much giving people ATM cards so that they can go and either take out money from the ATM machine or use it at a point of sale service to purchase goods as well. And there's also mobile. You know, one of the things about the world today in globalization is that you pretty much go to the most remote place in the world and people have cell phones. You know, I've been surprised at seeing, you know, refugees living in the worst conditions, but that have an iPhone. You know, connectivity to people is very important, and that's usually something that they will be able to preserve, in even in the worst cases. So there has been a lot of work done to getting money to people through their cell phones as well. And I will explain in a bit, an example in a bit about that. So what are the benefits about providing people with cash? Well, as I said first, they know their needs better than we do. By doing this, we're actually putting them at the center of the response. You know, instead of being active recipients of aid, we're actually making, instead of being passive recipients of aid, we're actually making them more active. We're making them be involved. You know, we're giving them the power to purchase what their family needs the most. They can also be used for a lot of different things. You know, they can use to purchase food, to access health services, or for a variety of things at the same time. In Turkey, we were doing a program, and one of the biggest needs was people was money to pay for their rent. So you know, we found that half of the money we were giving them was being used for rent, another percentage for food, and then even for clothes or other things because the winter got very cold. So this way, you're not just giving them one thing, but you're allowing them to cover a number of different needs as well. It also supports the local market and the economy. Usually, markets are very affected by any kind of crisis or disaster, and this is also a way to help them recover indirectly. It has been known in the past that you know, bringing large shipments of food from halfway across the world does actually harm the local markets. In Haiti after the earthquake, that was happening a lot, and one of the results was that the local agricultural sector almost completely collapsed. So even though we were trying to do something good by providing people with food, we were also doing a disadvantage to local industry. So therefore, this is also a benefit that we see in transferring the power, purchasing power to people. It is also technology friendly. I know earlier there was a question asked about innovation, and I will get to an example in a bit, but there is a lot of space to work with innovation and technology while doing cash. As you saw, you know, there's cash through the banking system, through ATMs. In fact, in Jordan, most people don't even need a bank card. The ATM there, the retina, as one of the people who's been identified, and it gives them cash. So there's a lot of space to work with technology to make things a lot more effective in order to get the aid there. And there's also the value for money. You know, doing cash does have its own costs, but we've seen as a humanitarian world that you save a lot of money on warehousing, on transportation, on packaging, on storing, on distributing goods. So this way it's also a bit more cost efficient for us as organizations, but also cost-efficient for people. In any disaster, and I'm sure my colleagues can tell you, when you give people goods in kind, if you go to the market the next day, you'll see some of them for sale. That happens a lot. But when you give somebody, let's say, a tarp that's worth $10, they go and sell it at the market, they're only going to get $5, $7, $2 maybe. So if you're just giving them the money directly, it gives them more value for them as well. So these are some of the benefits that we've found. And just to clarify, this is not just Save the Children that does it, like pretty much all the different organizations, you know, Red Cross, CARE, World Vision, we're all shifting towards this. It does have some limitations as well. It's not perfect. There needs to be willingness and acceptance locally. I've been to places where local authorities just don't want you to give cash. They have negative impressions of what the cash will be spent on, which evidence has proven is not true, but their initial impression is that it will. So sometimes they don't want the people to receive cash, they want people to receive goods. Functioning markets are also necessary. If there's not enough products in the market for people to buy, then there's no way of actually making it efficient. In some places, in really remote areas, and like for example, South Sudan, this is still not really a possibility because the markets aren't strong enough to support an injection of cash. Safety and security are a big consideration. You know, we want this, when we're trying to help people, we want to not put them in extra danger. We have found cases in which people who receive cash are targeted, which if, on the other hand, they would have received goods or in kind, they wouldn't have been targeted. So we need to take that into consideration as well. We don't want to put people at harm, or even put ourselves as the organizations, our staff, at harm either, because if something happens to us, we can't help anybody. And also timeliness. You know, some of these things are not easy to get off the ground, and especially after a natural disaster, something that happens really suddenly, sometimes setting up a system to provide people with cash is actually can be kind of slow, so sometimes it is easier to do goods. But that is another consideration. If we can set something up quickly, it's usually better. So I want to talk a little bit about specific outcomes that we found for women and children. And this isn't, again, this is based on a lot of research and evidence gathering that the whole humanitarian community has done in the last few years. Cash isn't a new thing, but it has come up in the agenda in the last few years, and there's been a lot more research on it. I think the first one, it says health there. You can't really see it. It got kind of hidden behind one of the other ones. But we have found, studies have found that there is an increased use of women's health services and care-seeking behavior through programs such as giving women vouchers to access private health care. So that is something that we've found. In terms of food security and nutrition, we have also found that people tend to buy and consume more diversified and more nutritious food groups when given cash, as well as kids using more supplemental nutritional supplements for pregnant and lactating women as well as for children. Education, we've also found that cash can be used to increase school enrollment and attendance rates, especially after an emergency. Giving children a sense of normalcy by helping them return to school is very important. So we have found that cash can also be used for that. More specifically for teenage girls, a few studies have found that if using cash the correct way, you can decrease incidences of teenage pregnancy as well as early marriage. And also of reducing the likelihood of emotional distress. As you all know, adolescents are perhaps some of the most emotionally vulnerable, and during an emergency, this can be very important. So being able to, cash has been shown to help them feel safer and feel more protected. Economic empowerment, I think both colleagues alluded to that, but we also have found that for women, using cash will help them increase savings, increase decision-making, increase negotiation skills, and start up their own income-generating activities as well. And gender relations, in some cases, if done properly, we found that you can reduce tensions at the household level and even violence and abuse. Specifically, a project that I ran in southern Turkey with Syrian refugees, in order to receive the cash, the family had to come in and for a workshop, and the workshop was about a joint decision making about how to spend the money they were going to receive. And we found that that was reducing tensions at the household level, and also was leading to less abuse. So there are some really important things that we found that cash can accomplish, but we've also found that it can't do everything. It's a tool to get aid out to people, but it's not the solution to all the problems. It doesn't reduce mortality rates in the community forever. It doesn't change things. So it needs to be really accompanied by other forms of aid, which can be trainings, which can be service delivery, I had a few more there, advocacy, protection mechanisms. So cash is just a tool that we can use, but it has to be part of a bigger picture that involves all these things. And it's been mentioned a few times already today, building resilience. So this is just one of the components that can be used, but you need to have others there as well. And just to give you a little bit of an example of how this works in practice, I don't know how many of you are aware of what's happening in Northeast Nigeria today, but since escalation of conflict a few years ago of the Boko Haram insurgency, I think it made the news when all the girls were kidnapped, but there's still a lot of issues there right now. Recently it was said that up to 5 million people are food insecure, and 120,000 of them are feared to already be suffering from famine. So Save the Children, along with a lot of other humanitarian organizations, have been trying to provide food to help people survive in Northeast Nigeria. The way that we're doing it as Save the Children, and again, this is not unique to us, other organizations are all doing very similar approaches, is through cell phones. So if you see down there, we identify the most vulnerable people, and we give them cards. This card has an account number on it. They can go to a number of different vendors. I think our list is about 50 different vendors throughout the region, where they can purchase food from them. So what they give the vendors is their account number. The vendor has a smartphone. We provided all the vendors with smartphones. Well, actually, most of them already had them. So. And then the same way that you would do online shopping, that's how they do it. They pick what they want, the vendor marks it on the cell phone. Once they've done selecting their items, they give the cell phone to the person. That person has their own unique PIN number. They put the PIN number into the phone, and immediately the company that we're working with, which is a cell phone company, immediately transfers the money to the vendor. And the people can take away their food. So this is a very effective way of getting food.
Paying attention to the news, watching what's happening south of the border, and politically speaking, right now, there has been a lot of talk from the new Donald Trump administration about cutting humanitarian aid, and a lot of rhetoric, especially around programs for women and children. Do you have any concerns about this, and what challenges could this possibly pose for your organizations and the programs that you're working on, and what can be done?
I can start. So there's always a concern when there's a discussion of any cut in aid funding, because there's already a significantly unmet gap in that funding. So anytime we hear of it decreasing, it obviously raises alarm, particularly targeting women's programs is of a big concern for us, for sure. We tend to focus a lot of our work on the prevention side of things as much as we can. Really key things like reproductive health services, you know, making sure that women giving birth have a trained caregiver there. So those programs are incredibly important. And we think of, you know, in these communities, often women are the core. They're the core of the family. They're the core of the resilience in a lot of times. So we do need to definitely continue the support for those programs, but again, the wider programs. We can't extricate women from the family. They're a core part of that, so we need to make sure that both continue.
So, I mean, I think Julie covered a lot of it, and I think from our perspective, I think to put this into context, there's unprecedented humanitarian need right now. We know that South Sudan, parts of it has been declared a famine, Northeast Nigeria, Yemen, Syria. So anytime there is a cut to humanitarian aid, as Julie said, that's an issue because there are such significant gaps. And I think as an organization, we're going to have to continue doing the work that we do because we are a humanitarian organization. We are inherently not political, we are impartial, and we are neutral. So we have to continue the work that we do. And that's where we call on other governments to increase funding and to support some of that gap. So yesterday, the government of Canada announced a significant amount of funding for what we're calling the four famines, Nigeria, Yemen, South Sudan, and Somalia. So we welcome that. And we also welcome, you know, advocacy from people like you. You're interested, write your MPs. You're interested, you can provide us funding as well. And that's actually a significant help as well, because that's often, you know, unrestricted with no strings attached. So for us, you know, we're gonna still continue saying what we have to say, because for us, it's non-negotiable. Supporting women and girls for us is critical to our mandate.
I completely agree with my two colleagues. Just to put it a bit into perspective, last year the US government provided $6.6 billion, American dollars, in humanitarian aid. They accounted for 30% of the total funding going to the major disasters around the world. We've heard from our colleagues in the US that the cuts could be up to 30% of that funding. So, you know, we're looking at maybe even up to $2 billion of deficit here, which is quite concerning, as been repeated, as there's not enough money already, so reducing it is very concerning. I think there is an expectation that's growing now on countries like Canada, Scandinavian countries, Japan, New Zealand, some of the kind of middle donors, to increase their aid. And hopefully we will see that. I think there's also sort of an expectation and a movement to try to also get the private sector more involved in humanitarian aid. And I know that most organizations have partnerships with certain private companies, but what doesn't exist is actually platforms and mechanisms for them to contribute to the wider forms of aid. You know, the UN has this emergency response fund, and that can be donated to by governments, but not by the private sector. So I think that's going to be something that we might, or that's trying to be explored more, is how the private sector can get involved. I think individuals, we also need to step up. I know, you know, Canada has had a very long tradition of very generous donors in kind of crisis, and we're setting the bar worldwide on accepting refugees. Like, the amount of resources that Canadians have done to sponsor refugees coming into Canada is an example for the rest of the world. But I think that we also need to start looking outside of Canada and how we can support the different organizations to provide aid in the field. And finally, I think the responsibility is also on us as the organizations. We need to be able to use the limited resources that there will be even better to reach more people. So we are also in the responsibility to become more effective. And that's through coordinating better with each other. And we're moving in that direction, but there's still work that we need to do in that sense as well.
Thank you. Simran mentioned, you know, that a lot of organizations who work in this field work hard, very hard, not to be political, but the discourse within various countries, even here in Canada, we see it south of the border as well, there appears to be a growing politicization of the conversations around humanitarian aid, especially when it comes to women and children, the global gag rule, things like that. How do we work, how do organizations like yours work to sort of combat this growing pressure from some groups, which wield a lot of political power, to sort of have these very narrow definitions about where funding can go? I know when Alejandro, you were giving your presentation and talking about putting money in the hands of people, that you know, that automatically jumped into my mind as a way of sort of taking that pressure out of the organizations. But But how do we combat this if there's growing politicization within various communities to sort of set narrow agendas about, you know, who you can help and how you can help them?
I think maybe to put this into context a little bit is that this is a pressure I think collectively we've been facing as organizations for probably the entirety of our organization. Because when you take, for example, the global gag rule, that was originally enacted in the 90s and then most of 2000s. So we've had to deal with that pressure. We've had to deal with that constant push and pull. But again, as organizations who are humanitarian as a core of our mandate, we have to respond, right? Like those are, there are needs on the ground. We have to respond and we have to respond effectively, which means looking at what that means for men, women, boys, and girls. And as Alejandro said, that requires us to be more effective and more efficient. And we do a lot of advocacy work as well, whether it's internally or externally, talking to other donors, talking to governments. Again, the government of Canada, for example, just announced $650 million for sexual and reproductive health. And that's really critical. And as Alejandro said, there are other governments who are stepping up this at time to kind of combat this growing politicization of aid.
Along the same lines as humanitarians, we have to stand on those humanitarian core principles of neutrality, impartiality, need-based. That's where it has to go, and we have to continue to do that, both for the beneficiaries on the ground as well as for the safety of our teams. We can't be seen as aligned that way. And the shift to cash is another key part of that, and that's the way that we're looking. You look towards the World Humanitarian Summit, right, where that was the call. It's not why do cash, it's why not. Right, we have to start thinking about that as one of our first line opportunities in the appropriate context, and that is that gives the power to the beneficiaries to decide what it is that they need most. Because just because you're a refugee living in Turkey doesn't mean you have the same needs as the refugee beside you.
I think they've said it all. I want to give you an example. We have a large office in the U.S. and since the day that Trump got elected, they've been through legal teams looking at different ways around it too, right? So it's not just, it is a very big risk. We've all felt it, but we're also looking at different options. So once we see how that is actually gonna play out, I don't know, I guess I could be better at answering this question, but we are definitely, within legal means, searching at different options to combat this type of negative rhetoric that is unfortunately growing around the world. Not just in the U.S.
I think we're running out of time, but is there anyone who has a question? You want to come up to the microphone?
I'll talk a lot to kind of that thing. So I'm just wondering, as a practitioner, working with women and girls, how do you really place yourself? Do you sometimes have to decide, you know, we need to bring a female caregiver, female service provider in, and then if you are in an area with different forms of modesty than Canada, do you dress in such a way, or would that be cultural misappropriation? Again, just placing yourself as a practitioner in different regions of the world.
I can probably go. So I spent a lot of time in Pakistan and in some pretty remote areas. And so I look to often my female colleagues, what are you wearing? What's happening? Because I don't want to draw attention to myself in those communities. I also don't want to place my colleagues and the local staff that we're working with in more risk. And practically as well, like we find that in certain contexts, if you don't have a needs assessment team or a team that's going out to the field that don't have women in it, you're not going to be talking to the women. And so from our perspective, that's one of the first things we look at when we do a needs assessment. Do you have women on the team? Are you doing separate discussions with women? Are you having those conversations? Because as practitioners, there's lots of communities where if you were a man trying to talk to a woman, that would not be culturally appropriate. And as an external to often other people's cultures, you have to walk that fine balance of respecting culture. And you know, it's not about me and my political beliefs, it's about ensuring that everyone around me is safe.
I would say the only other piece that we often add in some of those situations is it's key to make sure that you have the male community members on board as well. As Simran mentioned in her presentation, we can't just say we're going in to do a livelihoods training with women. And there's a lot of times in context where we do need to do information and awareness raising with the men first so that the women are allowed to attend those trainings. There's no value in us saying we have this great training, here you go, everybody come. and realize that none of them have the permission to leave their households and come to it. So it's both sides.
Yeah, definitely. Everything they've said is what we do too. Just give you a little example. In Yemen, we're setting up repairing some infrastructure for water, and we're doing that with the local government. And we told them, you know, we want a committee from the people to be managing it. And we were trying to do 50% women at least, and they were really pushed back on us. At first, there were no women in the committee. Now, a year and a half later, we have up to 30%, and we're hoping to reach 60% or 50% in this coming year. So it is also a lot of pushing, advocating, and you know, it doesn't happen immediately, but you have to keep on trying.
Thank you. In fact, I feel like I was being called from the hallway saying, wrap things up, Mom. Thank you so much, everyone, Alejandro, Simran, and Julie, for sharing your insights. A lot of very, very useful information also about what we can all do. Thank you, everybody, for joining us for the session.
Julie, Simran, and Alejandro, thank you. I feel like you've transported us into the lives of some of the beneficiaries that you work with, and that's so important to hear those stories and to really connect with the people, the faces behind the aid. Thank you so much. For everyone else, snacks, exits. We're taking a 10-minute break. Please come back afterwards. It's going to be fascinating. We're talking about humanitarian aid in...